Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. Pre-warning, before we go ahead, I am rotten with the cold, so if the voice sounds terrible, well, worse than usual, that's possibly why, and if I start fading out about an hour in, that's also why as well. But I am joined on this edition by two returning guests, but for the first time, they are together on the show, well, on screen, unless they're in different rooms in the same house. I am joined by the tag team, Fulton King, Sami Sparx, Legends Never Die. Welcome back, guys.
Thanks for having us, Billy. I appreciate
you having us.
Bearing through your cold to deal with us.
I am a professional, and I will work through the. Oh God, mind fog's already happened, and I'm only a minute in. We're gonna get through this. We're gonna be fine. We're gonna be good. If not, I'll leave you guys to ramble for a bit while I
easy peasy
cower in the corner a little bit and just have a wee cry.
Just before we get started, Billy, I need to bring attention. Sami, you were away when this was brought up. Billy's wearing a Pikachu hoodie, and it might be the most adorable thing I've ever seen in my life. So
I've got to see it.
Well, I got right. I'll take my headphones off so you get the full thing. So I won't be able to hear your reaction, but I will in the post. So here it goes.
Right.
This is for talk the video people.
Talk about him.
Yeah, fucking shite, man.
Oh, look at him go, man.
Yes, man.
Beautiful.
See, Kelly was going, you should probably wear your grey hoodie, so it looks like you're just wearing a normal, like, fleecy jumper. And I was like, ah, no. Pokemon's the way to go.
It is.
Because you know what it's like. We're all men here. Although, Sami, we just assume you are, because mask can
well, come mask. Out of
anything. Yeah. but we are bitches when it comes to having the cold and flu, so I'm just going
100%.
I'm just going for the comfiest as possible. I mean, to be honest, the fact that I'm still wearing joggers and not like Spider-Man pajamas is just a miracle at this stage. But other than that, this is a podcast about me just whinging about being ill, because by the time this comes out, I shouldn't be, because it'll be next year, it'll be 2024. I'm still ill at that point, and COVID has definitely got me. And anyway, right.
She's back.
Back with a vengeance. So I will be shut up with the mute button. We'll try not to cough in your ears. For my guests and for my audience, I will try not to do that. But in the meantime, let's talk about some wrestling and stuff before we get into loads of questions by Judas Gray, who asked, I think, about 10. So we'll get to them eventually.
Oh, Judas never disappoints when you're on this.
Oh, Judas is, he's, I won't tell to his face, but he's a good lad. Except when he's wrestling and he's an arsehole. So, you
know. I mean, I'd never tell him to his face either, because I don't think he's a good lad. Judas, you're a prick.
And shite.
Button. Right. Okay. So, this is not going to go well, guys. This is going to be a fun episode. I don't know if it's going to be an enjoyable episode for me, but it's going to be a fun episode for everyone else. So we're coming to about a year. Ish, or we will have at this point over a year of Legends Never Die being a thing. I think I've got it noted as about October 22 as the first official Legends Never Die-ness with the Choose Life match. Was that the first? That wasn't the first Legends Never Die.
That wasn't the first Legends Never Die.
No.
The first ever, I've got the date in my notes somewhere.
That's where I'm going.
The first ever Legends Never Die match, I don't have the date right now. But the first ever match was at the PCW Open Ring. Neither of his... Sami was just wearing his regular Sami Sparx gear, and I was just wearing my regular Fulton King gear plus a Sami Sparx t-shirt.
The date was the 30th of July, 2022.
There we go. And it was Legends Never Die versus Jordan Kane and Luke Ross. And just to let you know, we did go over because we are the big stars right here.
So
yeah, we went over with the move that we created.
Yep.
And I'm going to continue to say that every time I do a podcast, that we created the move.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you got to tell us the move though. What's the name of it? Just so people can know that's the name of the move.
It's called Tactics, Midnight. No, so Punk Tactics has been probably done before. I launched that thing, but we did have a move before that. Called Midnight Breakdown, and it's a pretty cool move. It's like I get them in like a mad half hatch suplex thing and I fling them round
and I go into a powerbomb,
but we quickly realized that not everyone can take it very well, So we don't do it anymore.
It's been done once.
It got done 1.5 times. Once, it looked great. That was during the debut.
And the other, I got kicked in the face.
Yeah.
So in actual fact, we're not celebrating 1 year of Legends Never Die. It's more accurately 18 months.
18 months of
Legends Never Die, when this episode goes out in January 2024. So a long journey, and we've probably talked about it before in past episodes, because as I was noting before, Fulton, your episode 175, which was November 2022, and Sami was episode 198, which was April 2023 release, and we're now on episode, should be, 244.
You're rattling these out, big man.
I know, I'm not, like, I don't know how, to be honest, but I've still got, like, now I've had two singles guys on, I'm just throwing the back on as tag teams. I've had Casino Brutale recently as well, and I should have Risky Business coming on in a couple of weeks, so I'm just like throwing them all together now just to make up the numbers. So, because I mean, by the time this comes out, we've got a t-shirt coming out right about the start of the year, and it's called Six Seasons in a T-shirt, for anyone that likes Community at all. And it has all the names of the guests we've had on the podcast, because you know that's the best way to sell money, by having people's names on it, because everyone likes a t-shirt with their own name on it. So yeah, I'm just like packing as many as I can before the end of the season, so I can just throw more names on there. Anyway, 18 months of Legends Never Die. We have probably discussed in the past where the name come from, but because we're doing an episode about the tag team in general, just remind us, how did Legends Never Die, the name, come about?
On my podcast, we spoke about it, and I actually got it wrong. I remember saying something, and I got it wrong. I think it was the album I got wrong, or the title of the song I got wrong for Fulton, and I got that wrong.
What a scumbag.
Terrible.
You're lucky you're wearing a mask, or I'd find you.
Okay, why is it my reason then? Let's see if you know my reason.
So Sami absolutely is in love with... he's that rapper that died. Juice WRLD has an album called Legends Never Die. So I'm also a really big fan of 4 Year Strong, pop punk band, who are far superior to Juice WRLD. And they have a song called Legends Never Die, Heroes Get Remembered. And I've actually got those words tattooed on me. So we were trying to figure out a tag team name in the back of the car, and we just stumbled across it, I think. And we were just shouting names at each other.
We were rattling, I think we rattled about 50 names off, and we said no to every single one of them. And legitimately, we were just running out of things. And it was only when I got to a point where I just started going on Spotify and going to the people's albums for me, that I started looking, because I was like, I'm running out of ideas. And it was when I saw that, Fulton openly said that he had it tattooed on him, and I completely forgot. So that's how we figured it out, just rattling things back off in a 2-hour car drive.
You remember the ones that didn't make it?
Oh, they were terrible. Probably, I actually can't remember a single one, I think.
They were really bad.
Like, there were just random names thrown together. Like, I think at one point I started up looking at words. So your tag team we saw was Lucha Lightning. Were we going to be like, we were thinking about stuff like the Electric Throne and all of that stuff, because you've got Sparx and King and shit. Like, it was embarrassing. I was sitting in the car with a pure like red face, and so it was Sami, but his is the mask.
It was bad.
Electric Throne. I mean, that's a team move. Maybe throw an electric chair into something, into a code breaker or something like that. You know, there's the Electric Throne.
This is really sore on everyone involved.
Yeah, thankfully I just watch wrestling, so I'm just throwing out these ideas, going, you guys can do that. It's no bother. I'll watch it. Just go. Yeah, that's a good plan.
To be fair, that's what we do with moves as well. So that could be cool.
You just find Lou King Sharp.
I saw a move on WWE recently, and I was like, I want to do it, and he was completely game for it. And then we started watching it more and more, and we both realized it's gonna suck. And it's like that Brutus ball where, so they've got him in like an electric chair, and he just cannonballs into them. And it's horrible.
That's because there's a very high chance that my head's getting landed on, and I do that enough myself.
On me. You land on me.
So the name was set. The team was happening. Was there a conscious thought between like kind of aesthetic? So you've got a bit more of a grungy kind of look as Legends Never Die with the jeans and the cutoffs and all that kind of thing. Was that? So I know Fulton, you've got quite an ECW kind of influence, especially Paul's Money. Was that
yes.
a conscious effort then? You thought Legends Never Die, it's got to be kind of rough and groundy and just a bit like, yeah, rough and ready.
I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, Sami, but I think the major part in sort of the aesthetic of Legends Never Die definitely comes from Liu Kang, Sharp, and Biffa. They were talking to... So it was basically... The tag team came together because we were training up with Liu Kang Sharp. And then me and Sami were just randomly put together on a tag, as like a tag training match. And Buffa said, oh, do you put these guys together because they've been tagging for a while or something? And it was the first time we'd ever tagged. And it was just this sort of instant chemistry, and it was a lot of fun. So it was really they two that helped push us even more with it. So it was Liu that came up with this idea of like, and him and Buffa were like, you ever seen Clerks or Jane Silent Bob? And I fucking love Kevin Smith. So it sort of, that's sort of where the aesthetic came from. And then it was Big Buffa that actually told me you should watch some Balls Mahoney. And that's when I fell madly in love with Balls Mahoney. And I was like, I'm going to cut my jeans any wee shots. And then it just all sort of came together, I think.
Was it where you kind of got, I mean, I don't know if you had a match in December, but was there any thoughts of maybe just doing the old Santa Claus, seeing as that is Balls Mahoney's... alter ego, just get the Santa gear, the black Santa gear going, just for one night only.
I think,
you know, it would be sick, but I don't know if anyone would understand it in the shows that we go to. It might pop Liu Kang Sharp, but even Sammy's sitting there like, what?
Don't do this.
No memory of Santa Claus. No.
Well, before we had like the ripped jeans and stuff, like Fulton says, it's completely off Buffa and Liu. We originally got tights.
Yes.
And we wore these tights maybe what? How many times? I don't think we've worn them that much, to be honest.
We've worn them at Attitude.
Yeah, I think we got them about 3, 4, 5 matches out of them. And then we switched the gear. And the main reason why I switched was I was going to be working heel. And it was one of the first times I'd ever worked heel. And I was like, well, I don't want to be going in bright red. I've already got the mask, which is not easy to try and get a crowd to hate you for the first time, because kids see a mask and go, oh, Rey Mysterio, and start cheering. And I was like, bright red mask, bright red tights. I'm like, it's not really going to help. So that's why I started wearing jeans. Not cut up or anything, just started wearing jeans with a belt. And it was a lot more comfier. And it was only like after Fulton cut his, I was like, this could actually look really cool. So I've got a pair of jeans that I wear, and then I cut up a pair of another jeans that I now wear more because I designed them. I put like a load of sticker in and like labels on them and stuff.
You used to have a mask or briefly that I saw in promo pictures that didn't have the top. It was just the front of the face. Is that just uncomfortable? Was it just a case you just wanted
to... No. It's more the fact that it nearly comes off in every single match.
Ah.
Okay. So it's literally just two straps. It's a Velcro strap at the bottom, and then it's just an elastic strap over at the top. So I'd take a bump and the top bit would slip off, and then the elastic would come undone. So I'm there holding it on my face.
I can confirm it's very easy for that mask to come off because we wore that. When we absolutely battled Termination Z the other month, I wore it to do it because every heel turn has a face reveal, obviously. And it was ridiculously uncomfortable to wear. And I was like, this is going to come off any second.
Just before we go any further, Santa Claus, from what I remember, anyway, was an evil Santa hired or paid for by Ted DiBiase. There you go, there's a little bit of education for those listening.
Yes.
It lasted, I think, one show because it was right about Christmas.
There was no return, I don't believe.
No, and not to be confused with Christmas Creature, which was Kane back in UWA? No, UWA? Oh, somewhere in Memphis, probably. Anyway, don't know why I've fixated on that. We'll move on. So we talked about the aesthetic, and then you became broiled as a team. So the first match I got noted was the Choose Life match with Glasgow Grindhouse, which I think we definitely have spoken about it before on both podcasts from the dates we've got here. But that was the first time really people were seeing you as a team against an established team like Glasgow Grindhouse, like Krieger and Luke King Sharp.
Yeah.
In a match that was chaotic from all accounts, from what I've read. Not sure. Is it online? If it is, I haven't seen it, unfortunately. But I've seen the
pictures. I think it's coming on soon.
Yeah, I think it's coming out soon.
So
it was chaotic. Every match with those two are. We've never had a straight-up tag match with them.
So, I mean, the Choose Life thing was it was pretty much an I Quit match, wasn't it? That was kind of the idea behind it, but with a little bit of a Scottish twist with the whole train spotting thing.
That was it, yeah. The show was Dane spotting, so we put that in.
So when it comes to that kind of thing, I mean, you mentioned Balls Mahoney, of course, we know ECW, all that kind of thing. Sami being chaotic lucha, and I've seen you do like no holds barred matches in Target online. And I know that you're very capable of just throwing yourself at shit and hoping for the best. Was that a match that you were just buzzing for? Because you're against a team that is established, like Sharp and Krieger, who are known for just a bit of chaos as well. Was it just a perfect storm?
For me, I was shitting myself because I'd recently faced Lou before this in a singles match at Target, and I've never felt someone hit as hard. And I knew, I was like, this is going to suck. I just knew. And I think I said to Fulton, I was like, this is going to suck. I was like, we're going to get absolutely rattled.
We got battled.
Yeah.
I think the lead up to that match, it was really exciting. I mean, again, the first thing was it ended up being for the ICW tag titles, which is wild because we've never wrestled in ICW before, but it's still massive for us to, you know, have had that. And then it was, you know, it was in Lochwinnock, Amphi Sulcates initially, so that's no far away from me, from where I grew up. Mom and dad were there, and I felt so bad that that's the first match my mom and dad came to. My nieces were there, and it was. I think to me, and I hope you would agree with me, Sami, that match let us know sort of the sort of shit that we want to be doing.
Absolutely.
Like, not just all, it doesn't always need to be mad hardcore stuff, but always a bit mental.
Like, I've fallen in love with them type of matches, man. I think my favorite thing out of that show though was the fact that your nieces came and they didn't even love us as much. It was a big strong man, right?
It was an absolute joke. Like, I love Ewan, right? Big Strong Man's one of my favorite wrestlers in the UK, and just a lovely guy. But for like weeks after it, one of my nieces just kept going, Big Strong Man. And I'm like, shut up, Casey. Enjoy Fulton King instead.
Ain't it always the way? But so yeah, that's the kind of style of Legend Never Die is a brawl, pretty much turning everything into a brawl if possible and making it a bit as wild as possible. But that was when you guys were properly on the map, so to speak, because you got the ICW tag title match and you were embroiled in that feud with Glasgow Grindhouse, which, they say, we've said, it's a big team. They've been around for a long time as well, very experienced and well-known in Scotland at the very least. Well, they did make an appearance on Five Star Wrestling. Let's not forget.
Yeah. Yes.
Let's forget who with, but Steph, they were definitely on TV for a little bit. Krieger wanted to get a shout out from his granny.
Luke King Sharp does not stop talking about how he was on TV.
I was on TV. As he told you, he's beating Devon Dudley.
We've
seen that match, have we not?
And he wrestled Swoggle as well. He tells us all these things in great detail, mainly because we ask though.
I just imagine him in the corner just going, bah, way back when technically I've beaten Triple H because lineally I've beaten Devon Dudley, who's beaten.
Like, it's literally, everything will be silent. No one will be talking. We'll just be chilling in the car. Like, we'll be going to another show and it will be silent. Then all of a sudden, I used to be on TV, you know. I had a maid. I had a chef. Yeah. And we're like, we've heard this like 9 times. Shut up.
He was Rey Mysterio Jr.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, it was. And a pair of joggies and a merch mask.
That's mad.
With the SmackDown GM of all people, it was just a crazy time.
I just thought it was wild.
I don't know. They were supposed to come up to Aberdeen, and it wasn't them. It was WOS that I ended up speaking to, and I was going to get tickets for, and I would press everything. I had everything. And then they cancelled, but Firestar was supposed to come up our way as well, but never happened. It's unfortunate, but yeah, there were. I've got the reviews on our site, the ones I did watch. It always starts the same. Missed the first two matches, but I saw the rest of them. And it was just, bring back Five-Star. The Tap and Snap champions back on the independents. Matt Riddle's back.
God. And thongs. Matt Riddle is back and thongs.
I know. How could a man look more naked?
Honestly, I'd prefer him to just have nothing on at that point. You know what I mean? I feel like it would not hurt so much.
Absolutely no. You're encouraging this to go even worse.
No boots, no knee pads, and tiny pants. So like, me as well. At this point,
it's just going to be the flip flops.
Just every time he wrestles, they just have a picture of his face superimposed over his crotch. Just so no, can't look at this anymore. How did we get here? Five-Star wrestling, bastards.
But yes, that match with Glasgow Grindhouse, I feel like that was sort of our coming out party, I guess. It was like the big sort of people got to see us who maybe never seen us before, because most of the time we wrestled, it was down in Target and it was never really in tags with each other. I think while this was going on, I was in a tag with somebody else. You were in a tag with somebody else.
I was in a tag with Soldato and part of Village Scotland, and you were with Chris Kendall.
Yeah. And it was something we wanted to do. Like, we've been pushing for it and pushing for it. And down at Target, I don't think it was time for it yet, for them at least anyway. But because this was like the first CCW Now Valor show in Scotland, they wanted to have a really strong tag division, and Luke King Sharp seen something in us and was like, buff, there we go, there's that match.
It was strange seeing him when you were announced for Target as a team. It was always just Fulton King, Sami Sparx, and if it was Autumn or someone was team with you. It was a while before they actually went Legends Never Die. So I don't, was that there? They weren't quite ready for the grungy kind of experience of Legends Never Die. They kind of wanted to keep you as Fulton King and Sami Sparx for a little bit longer, or was it just any particular reason?
I think it was just timing wise. I think where the tag division was in Target and like where we were, it would have been very weird for all of a sudden after us being like, because we've had a few matches, me and Fulton back and forth. I think it would have been weird for me to just start tagging with Sol all of a sudden to just be part of this brand new tag team called Legends Never Die that not a single target fan, if they don't follow our socials, would have seen, because it's Carlisle, do you know what I mean? There's not, well, I don't know, but there might not be a lot of Carlisle fans who would come up to Glasgow to watch this stuff, do you know what I mean? So for me to just go straight into a tag team with Fulton, it might have confused fans. So I think that's what it was. So it was more like a case of, oh, six man here, they're together. Six man here, they're together. And then it was kind of like, oh, these two work kind of well. I think that's what they were kind of going with.
Yeah, we were the kings of six-man tags in Target. The kings. We had so many six-person tags in Target. It's unbelievable.
Yeah, I was noticing, with many a different partner before officially you guys were an actual team. From there, my notes are all over the place now from this point onwards. I started writing stuff, and then I remembered, oh, I need to put this in, and I put it further down. So it's going to be, we'll get there eventually. You know how
it's going. That's fine. Does it need a structure?
I think I do need kind of a structure, but it helps when I actually write it as a structure and not just everywhere on this page on my nice little Spider-Man notepad.
Well, if you ever get lost, from what I've heard from Fulton openly told me that at any point you get lost, he's more than happy to talk about Gilmore Girls.
Oh, man, I've been...
Did I bring up that? No.
Oh, yes! Yes!
Every winter for the last 5 years, I've had to put up with that pish.
It's so good, mate.
No. I liked it the first time I watched it. The fourth time, Lorelai can fuck off.
Lorelai and Rory have such a wholesome relationship, right? And Dean just doesn't understand Rory at this point. And Jess is the bad boy, and Luke's just the best.
Luke, I agree with.
I've been watching a lot of Gilmore. Yeah!
But Rory is the worst human. I don't know why she's got three guys chasing her, because she seems like an absolute bollock to be with.
She's also such a bad actor. She's such a bad actor.
I've never seen this, by the way. Like, I've never seen Gilmore Girls, but I don't really watch a lot of TV, as Fulton will make multiple jokes about it.
Yes, you've still never seen
Don't Do It.
Hold on.
I have seen Clerks. No, I've watched the third one, or the first one, one of them.
The third one's the worst one.
I also watched Jay and Silent Bob straight back, because he made me watch it. And I just want to put it out there. Jay and Silent Bob is one of the worst films I've ever seen, and I will stick to this. I will stick to this.
Which one? Sorry, there's two of them.
Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back?
I like that one. Reboot was not good.
Reboot was a bit weak.
Reboot was...
I watched it, and I literally messaged him. I was like, this is awful. And then recently, the other argument that we've had is I got 5 minutes into Lord of the Rings and thought it was boring, and I turned it off.
No taste. The youth today.
See, Clerks 2...
The youth today...
Clerks 2 beautifully ruined Lord of the Rings for me. But I hated it anyway. It was too long.
Grow up, Billy.
I know, Billy, I'm with you. So the thing is, the worst part is he goes, oh, you need to watch the extended edition as well. Oh, yes. Sorry, Fulton. I didn't know I had 9 hours on my hands to watch a one film. Fuck off.
Ingrate to the Perrys.
It's just three films of walking.
Right, okay, Randall. Make sure you tell me that movie was so boring even the trees walked.
Exactly. There's only one return, guys, and it's Return of the Jedi. God, you need to watch Star Wars too.
Either, but we won't get into that.
See, I don't care about Star Wars. I mean, I've watched all up to The Force Awakens.
I don't know. I watched the first one. I watched the one where there was like racing in it, and I thought it was
that's what I call pod racing.
Yeah, and I hated it, and I was like, this is getting turned off.
Ah, no, I can see you as a Jar Jar Binks guy if you gave it a chance. I don't know why.
Whoa, hang on.
If you were the Star Wars character, you'd be either Jar Jar Binks, this is just Sammy, or the guy that's like Anakin Slaver. Hey, Annie!
Okay, was it Greedo? No, that's not Greedo.
No, Greedo's the one that gets shot.
Yeah. I can't remember off the top of my head, but I thought it was going to be, Snake Tarkin. It's a trap. Yeah, that one.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's just because of the red mask. That's kind of just makes
me. Now I need to go and watch Star Wars to get these references.
And it's probably best you don't. I'm being. Love you, Sammy.
I'm just getting my quota in for offending people on the podcast. I'm still really. Like, not embarrassed, but it still makes me laugh when I call Judas Grey Twilighty on the Halloween Hijinks episode of the podcast. Because every time I watch the clip again, I'm just like, oh, that was so unnecessary, but it was so funny at the same time.
He is very, very Edward Cullen-esque, though, isn't he?
Like, if you told me he was a vampire, you'd go, yeah, probably. You
know, yeah, I can see that.
Just all skulking and broody. Right, anyway. Well,
screw continue. You, Judas.
Ah, fuck him. I'm gonna ask you all like a million of his questions later anyway, so he's gonna get a good plug then. So at that point we've got Archie Bro debut.
Yes,
May, I think it was. Didn't write down the moments are because I was a triple threat, wasn't it?
It was KOE and Termination Z, even though it shouldn't have been Termination Z, they shouldn't have been in there. I should have had an opportunity to reunite with my two long lost brothers. And those scumbags showed up unannounced, and I'm furious about it.
But again, that's against another well-established team with KOE, which seems to be the wrestlers' tag team in Scotland, especially. If you ask a wrestler who the best tag team is, generally, I assume you two wouldn't have the same opinion. It would be Legends Never Die. But if you ask a wrestler who their favorite tag team is, it seems to be KOE is in there, very much the top three.
They're
awesome, though.
we wanted to wrestle KOE for so long. Like, I mean, so long. And then when we finally got that opportunity, we were so hyped. And then Termination Z took it away and ruined our lives.
Yeah, arseholes. But KOE are unreal. I was actually... because obviously KOE had been about for years and years and years as a tag team before that, even as wrestlers. So I was shitting my pants when we were going up against them. Just because I know how established they are, how good they are with their sequences, their tag team work, how in sync they are. But what felt really good about it was, I'm sure me and Sami can both say this, it didn't seem like we were, you know, out of place. You know,
it felt like we were on the same level. But I feel like that's happened a lot recently. Like, that we can, like, it feels like we can hold our own. Like, first it started, like, it was with KOE. And then I'd say around, like, the final, like, the two matches, the next two matches that we had with Glasgow Groundhouse, it didn't feel like we were just trainees. Like, it felt like, hey, we can hold our own. We're just as good as you. Do you know what I mean? Which was, like, really nice to, like, not, like, it was, like, really nice to have that moment. Do you know what I mean? That moment of realization that, hey, we're not, like, you don't need to worry about us in this match. We're going to hold our own.
Yeah, we know what to do.
Yeah, man. Thank you. I couldn't find the words.
So, I mean, I suppose not just because you did a bit of training thing at Girders and Looking Sharp's dojo and what have you, so you have a little bit of familiarity. But, of course, you guys did have matches against each other, as you mentioned, through Spotted Target and Lucha, well, Lucha Lightning, is that what you call it? I never saw that officially.
So it was Lucha Lightning because I would yet to have been allowed to be in Lucha Scotland because Lucha DS had a problem with it because it was like, he's not Scottish.
It's not Lucha UK, it's Lucha Scotland. I get his point.
Well, now it's Lucha UK and he can be happy with it.
Of course, the current tag team champion as of recording, writing. Recording. We're recording, not writing.
Yes, they are the current tag team champions.
Yep. So is that a target? Yeah. There we go. There we go. Yeah. That was the response I that probably deserved there. Yeah, so anyway, right. So you had that familiarity wrestling each other and also training with each other. Was when you realized that kind of thing? Was it just, I don't know where I'm going, reaffirmation that you were just like, yeah, this is what I want to do now. I want to be a tag team wrestler. Was that yes. Or you still got singles aspirations?
I mean, I think, and like Fulton can disagree if like I'm on the wrong page here, but I feel like the majority of the thing that we're focused on is this tag team. Like, we're not going to turn down singles bookings. If someone messages and gets single booking, that's completely fine. We will take them. We'll love them. We'll put on the best match that we can, singles or tag teams wise. But I think another thing is, even if we do get singles matches, most of the time, we'll still be there. Like, the other one will still be there.
Yeah, like, pretty much.
If I get a single, like, I don't know if I'm allowed to say because it's not my booking.
For example, when you work W3L, I'm always going to be there.
Yeah. So, like, when I work W3L, Fulton's there 90% of the time. I think Fulton's got a singles booking coming up. I'll be there. We care a lot about our tag. I wouldn't say we care. No, I would actually. Sorry, I'm wrong. I'd say we care more about our tag team than we do singles bookings, but we're not going to just throw single bookings to the side.
Yeah, 100%. And I think a big part of that is because I just don't want to fight you anymore because we punch lumps at each other so many times and it's really quite sore.
Oh, man. Like, the amount of times we have hit each other is mental. You've still yet to beat me, though.
Okay.
So there's no ego there, like you're saying. If someone goes, right, I just want Fulton King, for example, there's no like, well.
No, it's all love.
It's just, yeah, it's just all, it's all about getting that bag. That's the phrase nowadays, isn't it? Getting that bag.
I have no idea. I'm 30 years old, Billy. I don't have a clue.
Trying to get the bag.
I'm 33.
Is that a thing, Sammy?
Yeah, it's like trying to earn money, I think.
Is that what they say on TikTok?
You had TikTok as well, okay? You deleted it, okay? You still had it, though. Don't act like I'm the young one here.
You are the young one.
You are. I'm the oldest one here.
But you're no better. You're no better. All right.
But no, there's no jealousy involved. I think it's more a case of we want to try and push each other to do as best we can. So if it's in a tag team format, we're always going to be pushing each other. And if it's in singles stuff, we're absolutely always going to be pushing each other as well. Because I think really, I definitely want what's best for Sami, and I'm pretty sure he wants what's best for me as well.
I suppose at the end of the day, at the end of the day, is if one of you get a foot in the door in a company, it always breeds opportunity to bring the other in. So it should hopefully work out the best for everyone involved eventually, whenever that may be. So to just finish up the Glasgow Grindhouse bit then, of course, you ended up the series 2-1, I think, on CCW, which is now VALOR, as of this year, as the episode is released. So was that just a learning experience every time? Were you able to not just be the brawling tag team? Was there a little bit more of just a little bit of everything in those matches? Or what was your overall thoughts on that series?
For me, I was literally going to say, for me, like, I learned something every time, not just from Ludo, but from Krieger. Like, they've both got such different views on wrestling, yet it works so well. We also, when we went over to Copenhagen, they were there, we saw how similar we are to them. Like, it was so scary how similar we are, like, personality-wise when it comes to having a laugh and stuff. Yeah. So that was cool. But, like, the matches were all brawl. But it was all brawl. Like, I'd love to have, like, just a normal tag match with them, because I still feel like, again, no matter what type of match it is, I feel like I'm always going to learn something from Lou and Krieger. Without a second thought, I'll always learn something. But it was all brawl. I learned something every time, and it was just a fun, mental, crazy experience.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like... On you go, Billy, sorry.
No, on you go. You're the guest.
Those two, working with Lou and Big John Krieger, really... you really do learn a lot from them, because they have been about it for so long, and they've got two wildly different styles of wrestling. Like... Because obviously me and Krieger are pretty big guys, and learning big guy stuff from another big guy was ridiculously useful. Like, the amount of times, anytime we'd be talking about stuff, or if Krieger was up at training and things like that, I'd been like, you don't need to be down as much as you are, mate. Like, you're a big guy. Be up. You can find other ways for someone to put you down. You don't need to be giving away all your stuff right away, because it takes away the fact that, you know what, when you eventually do get slammed, it's going to be like fucking Andre and Hogan all over again. So wrestling those guys in those three matches was unreal. Not only did I learn, you know, some of deathmatch wrestling and a lot of hardcore stuff and brawling stuff, I also learned that taking a kendo stick to the ear is one of the worst fucking experiences I've ever had in my life. But you know what? You just fucking keep going with it, man. Like, things are going to hurt, but just go.
Yeah, like Fulton, I'll let Fulton say it, but Fulton recently said to him when we were talking to someone, he was like, it was about like having Lou holding a chair. It's the most terrifying thing.
The scariest noise in wrestling is when you're in the floor and Lou King Sharp is standing up with a chair shouting, "Up! Up!" Because that's getting launched at your head, Sabu style, man. Terrifying.
I was going to say about Big Sexy Krieger Nash, he's always been that guy that has always been up. Because you see big guys, oh Christ, the microphone went right in my mouth there. You see big guys going about and they hunch over like opponents, and they look smaller because of it. Whereas he's always been a guy that I've seen anyway, and this is way back in like Rock and Wrestle shows in 2015 or whatever it was, that he was always a guy that was always shoulders back, so everyone had to go up to him at all times. And I suppose that is, I don't think you notice it until you watch enough wrestling where you go, oh, That's a big guy thing. You've got to have someone come to your level and not hunch over to theirs, because then you like a hunchback.
You're totally right. And it takes ages. Well, it took me ages to sort of get my head around that, because one, growing up, I wasn't the tallest. All my pals were the same height or taller than me. And then two, when you're learning to wrestle, you're really trying not to fuck up in front of your trainers. So everything's really dainty, and like, so for the first few months of me wrestling, if I was tying up with Sami, I'd probably come right down to where Sami is rather than have him come up to me. And don't get me wrong, obviously Krieger and stuff like that were great, you know, were fantastic at telling me those things. But right off the get-go, Sami as well would put me in the boss if I was doing something like that. Or like Chris Kendall, who I did a lot of training with, is another big guy. He'd also be like, be bigger. So it really did help a massive amount. And if you're a big guy in wrestling, be a big guy in wrestling. Don't step very much. You can stand still and still get a lot of reactions.
Like, it's weird because like I'm 5'6", right? And it's weird seeing this because going watching my matches with Fulton back, us against each other, it's so weird thinking him taking an arm drag at the start of a match. Like, that's so weird to see. Like, nowadays, it would never happen. And it's because of not just Lou saying this, but also his brother, Krieger, saying it. Like,
everyone, so we were over in Sweden, and we were backstage, so I think it was... We had just had a match against the Covenant, I think it was, and I ripped the guy's eye out. But we were backstage. Krieger was there with Luke King Sharp as well. And it was at the end of the show. And everyone was just sort of leaving. And there was these two girls and they were talking to us. And they just looked up at me and Krieger and I went, brothers? I mean, Krieger just looked to them and went, aye, twins. Different mums, but... happens all the time.
Aye, but no, it's so weird. Like... thinking about it nowadays about like Adam is Fulton is a big guy. I've done it now. I did it last time. I've done it this time. Fulton is a big guy, and like to think that he was taking arm drags from me like ages ago is mental because it would never happen nowadays. So it's again, even me being a small guy, you're still learning. Do you know what I mean? You're learning what a big guy should be taking and what you should be trying to give out.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose at the start, when you're starting out, you're wanting to do, make sure you're doing all the wrestling. But yeah, as time goes on, you go, no, that's, I've done that bit, but I don't need to do that bit. And yeah. As I've seen from Luke King Sharp especially, you can do very little and still get a massive reaction out of it. Because, I mean, I've seen matches where Lou has, I don't think, taken many bumps, if any, and has just pulled his pants, he's like dug grease off at the end of a match. And that's got as big a reaction anything else that's happened. You know, so it's definitely a like the more you watch wrestling and the older you get, and me being 33 now, I'm watching it going, you don't need to do this much, guys. Just
yeah. I can be also, how are you just going to mention about ripping a guy's eye out so casually? You can't do that.
Oh yeah. Let's go back to that.
Can't mention that and just bypass it like it's nothing.
It happened in Sweden, so I kind of get done for it.
The old Swedish meatball, yeah.
The old Swedish meatball, that's the incident. So, with me and Sami were over in Sweden at Sphinx Wrestling Sid, who's now part of Valor. And we had a match against Dakota and Lucius, so the Covenant. I'd wrestled Lucius Amarok before in the Copenhagen Cup, and it was fantastic, so I was really excited to have this tag team match. And we had this match with them, and a couple of times something happened where Dakota wears like a mask, which is effectively just all black. There's no eye holes or anything like that. And I think he must have got clocked in the face a few times, probably by me.
And we literally we start backstage, and he comes into the training, it's literally just me sat down in the changing room, and the rest of them are at the door. And he comes in, starts talking to me, and he goes, "Oh, hold on one sec." And he sneezes, and his eye just like a balloon, just inflates. And what just happened? I'm like, everyone get in there and help.
There was a noise that came from it, not from the popping. It was just, we were all outside, and it was, and we're like, what the fuck? Sami comes running out like, guys, And then we go in and his eyes like boof, and I'm like, ah, shit, I just blinded a guy.
Like, literally, but none of us thought that. So Fulton went outside and I went out and I'm like, you're right, mate. And he's like, no, not really. I'm like, what's up? He's like, I just ripped a guy's eye out. And I was like, oh, it's not your fault, mate. And now he's so proud of it.
I'm not proud of it.
You tell everybody.
So what actually ended up happening was, during the match at one point, I think, he connected with my hand or something like that, and it was an accident. It caused a small like fracture in his eye socket, and there was some congealed blood in his nose from a nosebleed he'd had previously. Somebody blew his nose, an air pocket formed in his eye, right? So actually, I didn't rip a guy's eye out. But you start the story by saying, I ripped a guy's eye out, and the ending doesn't fucking matter.
Like, for weeks, he would be like, I don't start me, mate. I ripped a guy's eye out. And like, that was it. And I was like, fuck's sake.
And I'll do it again, god damn it.
You're just there going, watching Vader this tapes why... going, I did that as well. Vader ripped the guy's eye out. I did it.
That's another reason why I don't want singles matches with Fulton, because I'll be next.
Yeah, you will.
He's got the rep now, the rep of eye ripping.
I'm Stan Hansen. No, Tim Stan Hansen.
Speaking of that Scandinavian tournament then, of course, Fulton King is the king of Scandinavia.
The Copenhagen Cup winner, the final Copenhagen Cup winner for CCW, I believe. Since it's Valor now.
So saving the best to last, clearly. That was the deal.
And I might be the only Scottish guy to win it as well. I'm not too sure. I don't remember if Lord King Sharp's ever won it.
Now, is this a cup that's like you can defend, or is it just that's a night only and that means you'll always be the king of Scandinavia?
I love this so much.
The winner of the Copenhagen Cup gets an opportunity at the CCW Heavyweight Championship. CCW doesn't exist anymore.
Ah.
So guess who's not getting a championship shot?
No. But that was a fantastic night as well. It was my first time going to wrestling in Denmark, because me and Sammy, we went over previously, we'd only wrestled in Sweden. It was my first night wrestling in Denmark. I got to wrestle Lucius Amarok in the first round, who it was one of the best singles matches I'd ever had. And I was terrified because he was another big guy. I mean, I'm wrestling big guys. So I'm like, oh, can I lift you up? Most of the time, it's fine. And we had an absolute belter and I loved it. And then the second match was with one of my favorite people in wrestling, the Golden Boy, Charlie Anderson. And it was his first time ever wrestling abroad as well. Potentially going abroad, actually. I think that was his first time flying. And then the final was Big Tim Strange, who I battled. On record, I battled Tim Strange, just saying.
We do have not so much a question, more just a comment from Tim Strange, just saying, yeah. Nice to see two English lads doing so well for themselves.
He's determined, because when I first met Tim, I was living in Carlisle. So he's to him now, I'm just English. Same with Judas, actually, as well. I think I'm English. But a fun fact about Tim Strange is I am the only person to ever kick out of his lights out lariat.
There you go. Well, saying that, to be honest, before I heard Judas speak, and I thought he was English, and then when I heard him do a promo, I was like, oh, he's not. Okay.
Cool. Well, he is from Edinburgh, isn't he?
He's Edinburgh, isn't he?
Yeah, I know. The accent's a bit, you know, it wavers. Waverly. Yeah. I know, I'm on fire tonight. The paracetamol is doing good job. Right.
I'm one of them, man. Let's fucking go.
Getting all the puns in. Right. Anyway. And not to like just focus on your single stuff. Of course, Sammy, you had your match in Sweden recently, for the Swedish Heavyweight Championship as well. So
yeah,
much like
we're back. Back on Sunday.
Of course.
Well, it won't be Sunday when this came out. It won't be Sunday when this came back, because it will be months ago. But no, it was a really fun match. Really great. Had a great time. Their pizzas, by the way. So I was in Stockholm. Their pizzas are massive. They were massive.
Hold on, I'm going to stop you right there, Sammy. You went all the way to fucking Stockholm. In the winter, 75,000 feet of snow, and you come back and go, pizza was fucking class, by the way.
I was. That's something you would do, though. You're more like a food person than me. So you should.
If I went to Italy.
So you should be excited about that. No, don't do this. Sit back in your chair and let me say my story, okay? You've had your moment, all right? You sit there, okay? The good part of L&D is talking now. So I went to Stockholm. Got to have one of the best singles matches I've ever had, which was just another brawl, which was a lot of fun. Had a great pizza, had a great night out. The person that I was staying with owns a cinema, So we went for drinks there the first night I got there, and they played the promo that I made, like the promo that they put together, and they played that on like the giant like cinema screen, which it was such a good experience. And hopefully I get to go back soon. I don't know. And again, it's one of these things, but I definitely want to go back because it was so much fun, whether that's as a singles competitor or whether that's as Legends Never Die.
You kind of go back with Fulton because if he knows he's got cinema, he's gonna be like, "Well, I've got the extended cut of Lord of the Rings with me. We'll just pad out the weekend, guys."
We're going through the full view asking of us first, mate. Like, we need to do that.
You including Chase and Amy? I like Chase and Amy, but it's apparently not one of the popular ones.
I love Chase and Amy. I think Chase and Amy is a fantastic love story. I absolutely love it.
Don't watch films or TV.
Yeah. No, I think it's such a really good take on a love story. It's super. Oh, it's so good.
You know, I started watching. I downloaded a few episodes on the plane, and I regret it because I didn't. And I'd like got through like 4 or 5 episodes. And I didn't
this
think
is going to be like the best TV show ever. Right, on you go.
No, it won't be. It's Vampire Diaries.
Oh, for fuck.
Leave it alone, man. Leave it alone. It was the first thing that like popped up on my Netflix. I was like, I'll download 4 or 5 episodes. I watched them, and it was awful, and I was very upset.
I don't know why I was expecting you to go something like Breaking Bad or something and go, oh, I watched the first couple of episodes.
I've watched Breaking Bad. Breaking Bad is one of the best, if not the best TV show of all time.
There we go. We finally found something to agree with on television.
Vampire fucking dies.
Hey, have you watched it?
I've watched like when it first came out, I remember being on the telly going, this is dreadful.
Well, it's not changed.
No, it's not good.
Yeah, we started watching it when after Kelly went through her second go through of Gilmore Girls, and I wanted to tear what's left of my hair out. Yeah, I got about 4 episodes in, and we're like, no, this is.
See, so you did Gilmore Girls, and then you did Gilmore Girls with vampires.
Pretty much.
I'll tell you where I got to before I stopped, because I gave up midway through on the plane, and I just sat there with nothing to watch. I got 5 episodes in.
That's 5 hours of Vampire Diaries.
I always give, like, my rule is you give a TV show 5 episodes minimum before you can go, this is bad or not. Because a lot of people watch one episode and go, oh, it's awful. I'm always someone who's like, I'll give it 5 episodes because it actually might be good. It's just slow.
To be honest, that's probably a good rule for Breaking Bad. It takes a little bit to get going in that first season, and then it's phenomenal.
I just rewatched it, right? And I had this pure bizarre moment. So I started rewatching Breaking Bad because I seen like a clip on Facebook or something. I was like, I'm going to rewatch that. And then I went to the shop to go get some snacks, obviously. I'm a really healthy wrestler, so I got a big bag of Doritos and a can of cola. A big 2 liter bottle of cola.
What flavor?
I was in the.
That was my first
thought. Just like heat with Doritos. And I was in the shop, and this guy walks in front of me, and he's got a mustache, he's got a pair of glasses, he's got a green shirt on, and he's wearing like the khaki trousers. And he leaves, and I turn around to the guys in the shop, and I'm like, "You boys, you ever watched Breaking Bad?" And they're like, "I." And I'm like, "Do you know that guy's the fucking spitting image of Walter White?" And like 3 people behind the counter just went, "Holy fuck!" It was like magic. It was like it was meant to be. This was like 2 weeks ago.
Still let that breathe.
Wild moment.
Anyway, wrestling. Why not wrestling? Chat. So actually, I think I've not ran out, but we talked about Valor. We were speaking about Valor earlier, and an idea popped into my head. You were talking about wanting to maybe do an actual wrestling match with Glasgow Grindhouse that doesn't descend into a brawl, which still might. But an idea, guys at Valor, if you want to take on here, Valor rules. You know, like the Ring of Honor rules, Valor rules. So you've got to actually stick to a assigned rule set. There you go, guys. There's a free one for you. Yeah.
Oh, handshakes
like that, at start, and all that kind of thing, you know?
And then be the real bastard and don't do it. Oh, I love it.
Aye, absolutely. That's it. So there you go, guys at Valor. Here's a free one for you, if you want to take it. But speaking of them, they're back in February, so that's not too far away when this episode comes out. 17th of February, Kirk and Tilly, for the first Valor show. It's got Andy Roberts on it as well.
Yep. So that's the first date in Scotland, I believe. First Valor show is 20-something of January, 27th, and that's in Sweden. And then we've got Kirk and Tilly.
So as the general plan is, you're going to try and be on every show, if possible.
If it's possible.
I believe I'm on the Valor show in Sweden on the 27th. So that should be fun. I look forward to that.
I'm just so impressed about how coordinated it is. It's of course, Luke Sharpie heavily involved, and he's had great success in Scandinavia, but it just seems there's this like extra scene now of Scotland / Scandinavia that seems to cross over every so often with Valor, and with we've had Nitro Green over at Pro 2 as well, so it's a nice little like pocket scene within a European scene. It's intriguing to watch.
It's really cool, man, because obviously you've got like the UEFA stuff as well, which is like a bunch of different wrestling companies, you know, Andy Roberts, the UEFA heavyweight champion stuff, and then within UEFA as well, so UEFA is like NWA. Then within UEFA, you've got this other company, Valor, which is running Denmark, Sweden, Scotland, and England as well. They're going to be running northeast of England soon, I think. So it's really cool that this one company's stretching out globally. Like that really, really happens. And obviously, Luke King Sharp's a massive part of it, because I think you said before when I was speaking to Billy, he may be like 5'4", but he'd be 10 feet tall if he stood in his little black book. Do you know what I mean? He knows everything. And it's like, and one of the things I'd say about Liu Kang as well, and if you ever go to the Dojo of Excellence, you'll absolutely get this. If you work your ass off, like, you get opportunities. But it's not a case of you show up once and off you're on every show. It's a case of you need to be proving that you're working your ass off, listening to what he's saying. You know, if he's asking for a hand to go help set up a ring at W3L or, you know, whatever it may be down in Full Tilt in Newcastle sometimes, if you're willing to put the miles in and put the effort in, He's going to give you those opportunities if he thinks you're ready for it.
Yeah, like if... Go on. No, sorry. I was going to say that if you put in the hard work for him and like you help him out and you like show him that you're doing well, he'll work hard for you. Like, do you know what I mean? He'll make sure that you are trying to get these bookings like in Sweden, trying to help you get these bookings in Denmark. Like, it's all about hard work, do you know what I mean? Like when we first started training, the warm up killed us, man. And I mean killed us. It's one of the hardest workouts I've ever done. And like now that we've been doing it for how long? What, a year? A year now?
Yeah, just about a year, I think.
It still sucks, but it's not as bad as what it used to be. Mm-hmm. Which I feel like Lou's gonna hear this and immediately ramp it up even more because I've said that, but you know,
he told us that last week. Well, this week he told you.
Yeah, he literally, we're at training and he goes, expect next week to be a graft. And I'm like, fuck.
Well, at least you got like 5 weeks between us recording this and the episode going out to kind of get ready.
Oh, yeah.
Fucking oh, fuck. Yeah. Yes. We'll be fine.
Unless he pays £1 and joins us on Patreon and listens to it early.
I wouldn't put it past him.
So you'll find out in a couple of weeks. If he's listened to it early, then you're fucked.
I feel like you'd do it if you tag him on the like the X like post that you'll put saying that we've all recorded and everything's done.
Just call it Twitter.
Oh, Twitter then. Okay, sorry. Twitter.
I'll probably be back to Twitter when this episode comes out anyway. Because
yeah,
who calls it X? And to be honest, I get the fear every time I've got a link come up saying X.com. I'm like,
what the fuck is that?
Who's sharing porn? I mean, no, it's Twitter. Okay.
Yeah. <Cool. laughs>
God,
every time in a group chat I get a link and it's like an X thing, I'm like, I don't know what to do. I click on that. That's a bit dodgy. But yeah, I think the opportunities we've had over the last year, I think for both of us, we know that it's more than really most people get the opportunity to do. Maybe if they've been wrestling for 10 plus years. You know, Sammy's been doing this for quite a while. I've been doing this for coming up on 2.5 years or something like that now. I don't remember when I actually started training, but it's amazing. We're literally getting to see parts of the world we never thought we'd go to, and we get to go do it and have some of them wrestle. Like, we get to go to Sweden or Denmark and pick people up and put them down in uncomfortable ways. What more could you ask?
Living the dream. Living the dream. The other match we've got coming up is before this episode goes out will be this Saturday. No, Friday. As of release date. Attitude Pro. You've got Rugged Rumble. Against Termination Z, as you've already mentioned, or Termination Z. I don't know. I haven't seen them wrestle as a.
Who cares?
Okay.
Honestly, Termination Z.
Who cares?
Cool. So you've got them, and I'm assuming you guys will be in the Rumble as well at some point. Although it's not been announced as yet. So you've already mentioned your distaste for Termination Z and the interrupting matches, the dream matches that you had with KOE. So again, that's a team that's got a little bit similarity to you. They've got a guy that likes to pick up and put people down in Big Ross, and someone who likes to chaotically throw their body about in Darrow. So in that kind of environment where you've got a similar team, I suppose like Glasgow Grindhouse as well, as you mentioned, is that kind of complementary style work for you, or do you prefer two big guys, two little guys? What's your kind of preference when it comes to opponents?
If I'm being very honest, I'm happy with anybody. Do you know what I mean? Like, I feel like size, height doesn't really matter. If like you can throw me about, cool. If you can outpace me, cool. I just want to wrestle as many different people as I possibly can. That's my take on it.
Yeah, it's pretty sick. I think for me, like, I love wrestling little guys because I feel like spending so much time training with Sami, working with Sami, teaming with Sami, wrestling against Sami, I try and move quite a bit. So like that Anarchy Rules leg lariat over the top rope sort of thing, that's... I like, you don't see many bigger guys do stuff like that. So I think wrestling a lot of smaller guys has made me adapt my own style to do that. But saying that, I love wrestling heavyweights because I feel like most of the time there's not a lot of people that are my size or bigger. So it gives me an opportunity to learn from them as well. Big Ross, however, isn't that fucking big. He's a wee dafty in my mind.
So we'll go into the questions then because we've got loads to go through. We'll leave all of Judas's for one go because he's, like I say, he's got loads.
I think I've got one as well that I got DM'd.
Ooh, DM'd you? Who's slaying it at you? DM'd you, dog? Or was it just Judas again?
Nah, it's a Big Roy story, I believe.
Oh, fair.
We'll get that one out of the way first. We'll get that in and then I can just rattle through what I've got. Okay. So what is Big Roy Story asking? I don't know if I can answer it. I don't know what the question is.
Big Roy Story asked us, is, are we in awe of how great Roy Story and Golden Boy are?
Yes, in short. So you've probably seen, if you watch some Target shows, you've probably seen Roy Story before, the personification of greatness, and probably Charlie Anderson as well. He's also been on some of the Valor stuff. Mm-hmm. He's the team leader. And I think, honestly, character-wise, those are some of the two best character wrestlers I've ever seen. And I loved wrestling them. Me and you have wrestled them a bunch. You think, how many times did you wrestle?
So this is like my favorite fact of this year. This year, in the space of 7 months, me and Golden Boy wrestled each other 12 times.
Which is a horrific amount of wrestling to be had with
one person. We got to a point, and it was in one of the tag matches with Fulton. We're just in the middle of the ring and we just started legit punching each other because, like...
We've done everything else.
He forgot what we were doing. He forgot what he was doing. I forgot what I was doing. And we just got sick of each other, if I'm being very honest. And we legit, on the floor, started rolling around punching each other. And we got backstage and Fulton goes, what fuck was that? And I'm like, we're just done. We're done. I don't want to do this anymore. Go away.
In short, I am in awe of both of them.
I feel really bad. When I was watching, because during some sort of pandemic time, I was going through the Target shows. That's how I started praising Fulton constantly on the website. But one person I didn't compliment was Roy Story. And yeah. I think I wrote once, so it must be one of his first couple of matches, I was like, is this guy supposed to be shite? Is that the point? Words to that effect.
You need to get Roy on this podcast, man.
That's fucking amazing.
And he replied back to it after I put the review out going, yes, I'm supposed to be. It's like, okay, cool. That's fine. I got it. I just felt really bad about it. And I just went, is this guy supposed to be rubbish? Am I missing something here? If he's called himself the personification of greatness and he's not good, am I?
Yeah. Roy Slotty once slammed me.
That was mad.
Chris Kendo and Fulton King versus Roy Story and Damon Havoc, and Roy Story slammed me, and he fucked it by doing a victory lap of the ring rather than pinning me.
But so I'm going to put a public apology out. I'm sorry, Roy Story, for calling you rubbish.
If you have a lot of good laugh with someone on this podcast, get Roy on it. Get Roy and Golden Boy together. You will.
Oh God.
You would legitimately. I think you would have such a fun time.
I think I need to do some building towards getting Roy Story on. I don't know if he's forgiven me for such a comment. I haven't asked him either, so I mean, I'm too scared to. I'm just like, I don't want to bring it up just in case he goes, oh yeah, I forgot you said that, and then
he shoots me on you in the middle of the interview. That would be so funny.
Oh, exactly. Nothing worse than someone just laying into me at an interview, which if people are listening to these chronologically. Has happened very recently, so let's that wasn't the best time. It was a very awkward moment on a podcast.
Oh, really? You know,
yep. Oh, my connection is stable.
Yeah, you good?
I'm back. Yeah, welcome
back.
You're back.
Well, we'll find out when I don't edit it if all that stayed in. Anyway, right, back to the questions. Where did I stop with you guys? Was it just talking about awkwardness of people shooting on you in interviews? Did you get that bit? And then
yes,
everything. Yeah, we got that.
Cool. Yeah. That's fine. Moving on. We've got James Blair, aka Old School Cool, aka mm-hmm. Mr. Blair, aka James Blair. Why is Fulton so handsome?
I don't know, man.
Genetics in it.
Stem cells and soul coats hardening. Because of Ayrshire and we're all babes down there.
And it follows up with, and does Sami know flips are killing his knees?
Yes, I know flips are killing my knees, but I try and be careful nowadays. I used to, this is an ongoing thing and a running joke. My knees are heavily usually in pain. Because the first 4 years of me training, I thought I was invincible and didn't train with knee pads. So my knees have the occasion to just feel stiff sometimes.
His knees are like bags of fucking sand. And I keep saying, go to the doctors. And he's like, no, I can still walk. I'm like,
oh. If I can walk, I'm fine. Do you know what I mean? But that's most wrestlers, isn't it?
We mentioned Matt Riddle at the start there being naked because he doesn't wear knee pads and boots and what have you. Just something about watching a wrestler going out with no knee pads. Just
see that gives me the fear nowadays. It's looking at a wrestler who doesn't wear knee pads, and the thing that gives Adam the fear is wrestlers who only wear ankle socks with boots.
Oh yeah, right. So I seen a picture, and I think it was Matt Cardona, and like it was a picture of his boot, he taking his boot off, and he had ankle socks on with his boots, and I think that's just rank rotten, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm.
I agree. Just wearing that in high tops is that's creep behavior. That, you know. So yeah. you need the barrier between your foot and a shoe. That's just.
It was the GCW show, weren't it? It was a GCW show that we were watching because he wanted to watch Bussy with team with
the what's insane the guy's clown name? Posse.
The insane clown posse or whatever his name is.
Yes.
That's what it was, because he was absolutely determined. He's a giant fucking Bussy fan. Aren't you?
Ali Catch and Effie are two of the most entertaining wrestlers in the world right now.
That's a tag team I'd love to wrestle.
That sucks. Like, I hated it. I used to wear a high top Converse, but I would wear my socks, but I'd pull up my socks like I was fucking looking like Jay from Jay and Silent Bob. That's kind of how it worked. Yep. I just pulled them right up, and she just looked at me going, "How old are you? Your name busted. You're not a busted anymore." I was never in busted, but yeah, it's like, but I can't have the socks go down because they look silly, but it's a delicate fine line. And I just gave up wearing high tops because that's just easier now. I'll just wear normal trainers like a 30.
It's creep behavior. You're absolutely correct. I fully agree 100%, and I'm glad you're on my side.
Absolutely. Same
before
with
before Matt Cardona hears this, that would be really funny and make my day.
Oh, it would make my view count go absolutely through the roof. So I'd be quite happy. same behavior with ankle socks and just shoes, and then you can just see the ankle between the shoe and trousers. That's no, they haven't that either.
I'm just a sock guy. I just like a pair of socks. Do you know what I mean?
Just exposing the fetishes and kinks on the SWM podcast here. But no,
someone asked to buy my socks once.
Oh, here we go.
This is great.
Someone
reached out to me on Twitter, and I was particularly skint this month. And he was like, "Hi, sir." And I was like, "I don't know who this person is." All right, mate. It was so I understand you're a wrestler. Yes. Would you be interested in selling me your socks? And I didn't even flinch. And I was like, how much? and then he was like, do you get awful sweaty in your socks? And I was like, if I'm training, mate, how much? And then
I'll get as sweaty as you want, boy. You just pay me.
And he came to training on Monday with these socks and put them on and trained in his boots with him. And the guy never replied to him.
I was like, I'm going to wear these socks. I'm going to sell them for £50 a sock. I'm going to be fucking minted. Then he get back to me, but and I was furious.
You know, I think that's one of those like it's probably on the surface sounds a bit creepy, but it's the most harmless of fetishes. You know, who's it hurts?
So what we're saying is, sock guy, if you're listening to this, them socks are still available.
they're a wee zip up bag ready. They're just...
or anyone listening. If you want a pair of Footwing King's ring-worn socks, let me know. £50 a sock, £75 for a pair. I'll do you a deal.
I mean, I'll put it out there. If you want a podcaster socks, I'll sell as well. I don't mind. I mean,
yes, Billy.
Yes, come on, Billy. If you want a luchador socks, we'd have to have a talk.
I'll throw in an 8x10. I'll get 8x10.
Oof, the feeling. Generous.
I say if I said, I'll just go with, like Vista print and print off 45 copies of the same photo and just sign it in a silver marker pen. That'll do.
Sign the original photo and copy that.
There you go.
You don't need to sign them all.
There you go. 5 pence per. You just go to the library and just print them all off. What are you doing, sir?
That's it.
Don't ask questions. Just it's fine. Don't worry about it. Right. So that was James Blair. Where are we? So we've got Chris Kendall, who's been mentioned already on the podcast, asking, how does it feel for Sami to be Fulton's second best tag partner?
It's just not true, is it? It's just not true. I see you putting your arm.
Hold on,
like
I'm not going to defend him. I'm going to say he did leave me at the hands of Tim Strange in Asylum at one point. So, I mean, okay. I feel like just because of that, there's no way, and among other reasons, Sami, don't worry, he can't be the best tag partner I've ever had.
I was going to say, I saw the arm go like that, like he was going to say something, but there's no way he's about to defend him, because then we are getting off this podcast and having a conversation.
I'm not going to defend that disgusting behavior. Chris Kendall, I think, is an underrated wrestler in the UK. Obviously, he's been pretty solid to target, and I'm hoping he's starting to get out there a little bit more as well, because he absolutely deserves it.
Me and Chris started near enough the same time on shows, and he was miles ahead of me, and I learned a lot just from training with him and stuff like that. So honestly, he's like not used as much as he should be in the UK scene.
But I feel he will.
I'm going to go to Instagram now, because there's one question that we've got from someone who will be a very familiar name that I kind of want to leave to the end, because it's actually a good question for a podcast. It's not Judas's fucking nonsense. Right, okay, so we've got Ian Skinner. Not to strike fear into people.
Please not how many games question.
Oh, no, he's saved that for an episode I've recorded tomorrow, and I hate the question, and he keeps putting it in, and I keep asking it, and it hurts my brain.
Fulton, did you ever get asked this question? Like, that, like unlimited games, but no bacon, unlimited bacon, but no games, or games, but no games?
Right, I'll find the question.
Hold on. Billy's gonna ask you this question now. Not even Ian's not even gonna ask it. It's
a horrific question. Where is it? Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no, that's it. Hang on. Where is it? Would you rather have unlimited bacon but no more video games, or games, unlimited games, but no more games?
I mean, I'm going to take the bacon one, because the second one sounds like there's no games at all. The first one sounds like you're still getting bacon.
So that's what I said. And then I got a reply after he listened to the podcast saying that you have sinned. I'm like, what? I don't even know you.
Hold on. I watched Ian Skinner sit in this podcast eating a cucumber raw while talking to you, and he's saying that you've sinned. That is the creepiest behavior I've ever seen in my life. Argue with fucking Kid Bandit and Simon Miller all you want, me, but if you're sitting scranning a fucking raw cucumber on camera, you need to get something sorted, brother.
I love that whole thing, because that's when you find out about watermelon sugar as a thing. You put sugar on a cucumber, it tastes like watermelon. Yeah. If you watch back the episode, I think I put it as a best of clip as well, because it was so fucking funny at the time. But yeah, he put sugar on the. He went away. On the podcast, he left the podcast for a moment to put sugar on the cucumber, and it tastes like watermelon, like Fulton, a grainy watermelon, but like watermelon.
Fulton, have you got
cucumber? I don't.
I was going to say, oh man, I don't even think I do.
I've got milk, and I've already had a cup of tea on here. Do you know what I mean?
So yeah, everyone should watch the Ian Skinner episodes, because they're never what you expect. Like the Austin Powers one, especially.
I was going to say a lot of talk about Austin Powers.
Oh yeah,
understandably so. Though it's a great show.
It's probably the perfect trilogy. You know, when you come to think of it, it's a perfect trilogy.
Now that I have seen.
Do you know what? I think you might be right, because I don't think there's anything funnier than you crazy Dutch bastard.
Oh, Goldmember gets quoted in this house almost constantly. Oh, it's fantastic.
Shave me from myself.
Like it's one of those films where they keep going, "Oh, Austin Powers 4 coming." It's like, no. Perfect Leave trilogy. It. Perfect. Don't ruin it. Leave it.
You're right. I will agree. I think the Austin Powers trilogy may be a perfect trilogy.
Yeah. I mean, I've thought Back to the Future for years, but it's probably a second, I would think. But Austin Powers is first.
Yeah, I mean, Back to the Future poster back there.
No, in the back. Back. I've broken. I've gone.
Oh, my God. The parasite impulse hit.
Fulton, start rumbling.
I'm going to take my top off.
Oh, Jesus. Right, one time I missed the mute button. Anyway, Ian Skinner, he asks, not about limited games, that's for my fun tomorrow. What kind of name is Soap anyway? And he's just put in brackets, if they don't get this reference, shame. So you're Sid either way.
Well, yeah, shame, but the answer I would say is succinct, efficient, practical. I don't get the reference, though. And I'm going to kick myself if I know what it is.
Is it a Call of Duty reference?
I don't know. I'm going to Google right
now. That's what I've done as well.
It could be Call of Duty.
Yeah, because every time I put that in, what kind of name is Soap? It's all Call of Duty 4 references.
Yeah, because...
Yeah, what the hell kind of name is Soap?
Yeah, it is. That annoyed me, because I should have got that.
Was it Kevin McKidd?
Yeah, it's Captain Price's first words to Soap. It's, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's annoying. I should have got that.
I'm not a little fucking nailed. Actually, that's why I fucking...
You literally sit and play Valorant and Baldur's Gate. Do not.
Baldur's Gate 3 is one of the best games ever released. I just never got into the Call of Duty. I never did Call of Duty. I wasn't one of those Xbox 360 guys, you know, giving people abuse online. I was a Discord, play Valorant and Baldur's Gate 3.
So nerd.
Sorry, you kind of lost calling anyone a nerd when you mentioned Discord, because that's just like a nerd central hub.
I also do have like a bunch of Dungeons and Dragons book to the left of me.
You've brewed your
argument. I was going to say this motherfucker.
I more recently have been learning how to play Magic the Gathering.
Really? You're getting onto that as well?
It's really good.
Play Pokemon like an adult. God.
Have you ever played the Pokemon card game? It's fucking trash. It makes no sense.
I mean, back in my day, we were too thick to really figure out all the gems and all that shit. We were just like...
Yu-Gi-Oh was great. The Yu-Gi-Oh card game was great.
I had Pokemon cards growing up. Couldn't tell you how to play the game.
I've went through a period. There was a house right about here, and I'd go walk a dog around the block, and somehow I would always find a Pokemon card. I've got like 10 of them, of varying of condition, and it was my wee bit of excitement going to walk the dog. Will I find a Pokemon card today? Oh, it's exciting!
James Woods. Oh, piece of candy.
I was never a Pokemon guy. Like I got into Pokemon when I was in high school, like the video games. I mean, but I was mainly like a Yu-Gi-Oh kid. Like I loved the Yu-Gi-Oh cards and stuff.
I recently on what was it AliExpress bought Pokemon Crystal.
Gen 2 was the first Pokemon game I played, and I absolutely loved it.
But the weirdest thing is, do you remember what Pokemon Crystal looked like?
It was like shiny cartridge that had like Suicune on the front of it.
It looks like a normal. This is the one I got from AliExpress, and it works perfectly. But
it's definitely not.
It's definitely not. But it cost me like £3. I was like, yes, please.
I feel like an original Pokemon Crystal is way more than and a Game Boy Advance. My man.
I know. Unfortunately, I realized when playing a Game Boy Advance is the light, the backlight is fucking shocking, and I know why I wear glasses now because that's
Fulton. You play a lot of like the like off brand like Pokemon on like your PC, don't you? Like I know you've played a couple of them.
Oh yeah, I played a few weird ones when I had an Android. I had loads of ROM versions. It was a very weird time because there were some very interesting things. Versions,
it's
that's the word.
It's a bit wild. There's one right now where you can fuse all the Pokemon together and you'll see some of the most cursed images of your life. I once fused on it.
Billy's just going to write that down in his notes. He's going to ask after the podcast, so what's it called?
I fused. No, this was great though. I'm a cargo and a Rotom together. They're like more than Pokemon or whatever. And it just made a lava lamp.
I hated the concept of Rotom, but that's kind of got me on board a little bit with a lava lamp.
Yeah, it was pretty sick.
Right, back to the questions. We've got James Blair back. He's now on Instagram, which is very new school for old school cool.
Yep.
Right, so we've got, why does Sparky plug Sami wear a mask? And then he's also asked again, why Fulton so pretty?
What a guy.
Sparky plug?
Yep.
We've only ever spoke about this on one other podcast, right? But the real reason that Sami wears a mask is...
No, don't do it. You got me in so much trouble the last podcast for this.
About 17 years ago, Sami was part of the Mexican cartel. He was a drug mule. And he wanted out of that life. And unfortunately, they weren't willing to do it. So he poisoned a very expensive bottle of brandy and had to go on the run. And he's been wearing a mask ever since.
I had to move because they found me again because of you. Now I'm going to have to move again.
What can I say, bud? Shouldn't I poison the cartel, you fucking idiot?
Well, you know what? I'll come live with you then. You can deal with it.
I'm living on one bed.
You have a couch.
Maybe we save our heating.
I've got my heating on right now and I'm absolutely roasting. So when I said I was trying to take my top off, I'm kind of getting serious about it.
There you go. That's the big finale. We'll all just get our shirts off. And...
Did you ever watch the Chuck Taylor and Trent Beretta show Talking Dogs and Popping Hogs or something like that?
What?
No, but the name is I don't know if it's intrigued me or scared me.
It was like a High Spots Wrestling Network TV show they had, right? And it was the best friends. It was Chuck Taylor and Trent Beretta drinking beers with another independent wrestler, right? And they were just getting steamy and talking about stuff. And at the end of every episode, they would all take their tops off, take a picture and send it to The Rock on Twitter. And then they stopped doing the episode because The Rock responded to one of them.
So what I'm hearing is we're going to do this today.
I think that's the only thing we should do.
I'm willing.
Right, okay, maybe. Why not? You know, what's The Rock going to do? I don't know whether to do it on the recording or just do it afterwards.
We do it on the recording.
We'll do it on the recording, but we each need to send a picture from each of our Twitters. Or is that you can't, no, each no, no, of wait, our ex accounts?
You can't send it on Twitter anymore, can you? Because you like need to have like premium, so just send it on Instagram.
Yeah, which is really annoying because Eric Young put out a thing going DM me for bookings. I thought, oh, I'll make it Eric, try and get Eric Young on the podcast, you know? And I tried message him and it said you have to be verified. I was like, fuck
it. Yeah, you need to like subscribe to like Twitter.
Yeah,
now.
We don't need DM, we'll at him on Twitter.
No.
We'll absolutely not.
We will DM him on Instagram. No, I am not.
Absolutely. If you want to at him on Twitter, you're going to be the only one. We'll send it for your DM.
We will all DM the Rock. But yeah, okay. I will not do it publicly. Nobody needs to see that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
I've got no hair on top. I've got hair everywhere else. So it's not a good look for me.
This is the reverse.
Aerodynamic, that's why, you know, I don't need to be aerodynamic
to do a third podcast, like a third like podcast episode, and it's just absolutely 10 times worse than this, because I've loved this. I can't wait till our third one's going to be us reviewing a movie.
I have the body hair of a luchador.
You know what, I need to make that a thing, because I think Ian made it so much fun that literally everyone's, because I think Alex Webbs was doing all the Spider-Man films. I think just the third episode should just
okay. Do you know what? Yes. Next year we do another one and we'll review a movie.
Well, all watch
the Kevin Smith one.
I agree. Mallrats.
Wait.
Mallrats.
Do
again. One time you lose.
Right. Okay. Mallrats. That's fine. We've already got the confirmation.
There you go. Mallrats. So Buffer has put in a little message as well on the Instagrams. He's put, so proud of you guys. Shout out to SWN. Thank you. Past guest on the show. See you soon.
Yeah, that's amazing. Buffer is just one of the nicest guys ever and a fountain of knowledge and really helped me and Sammy a lot. In fact, he put a story up the other day. It was like a tag movie he did with his brother and I was like, mate, that was sick. You know, and I obviously already sent it to Sammy being like, here, we should really do this move. And I was like going to ease into asking him if I could use the move. I mean, Sammy could use the move. And I was like, mate, that move's sick. And his first response was, you guys should use it. And I'm like, yes, brother.
Amazing.
Honestly, Buffer is so like good, not just like knowledge wise, but like everything that he does, there's a reason behind it when he's in the ring. And that's so cool. And I can't wait till he comes back over.
So, of course, past guest of the show, so if everyone wants to go listen to that episode, watch me get a little bit scared when I go, oh, you guys are similar to Crime Time for his tag team, and then it just... He was not happy with that comment. Like, yes. He was not happy with it, but he was a very nice man overall. I got back on board with dinosaur questions and whatnot. So last question I've got on the Instagram is from Ernest Boggs, which is actually a very similar question to one we got from Amelia Hughes as well on Twitter, which was, who's a British wrestler that you want to or yet to face?
A British wrestler that I've yet to face?
Very recently, we went to the TNT GCW show, we went to one of them, and Charles Crowley absolutely blew my mind. It was one of the coolest entrances, perfectly timed. He's just so creative with everything he does. Like, let's not forget the fact that it was a fucking incredible match he had with Shea. And I should say, I loved wrestling Shea. And then just seeing this match they had at TNT, I was like, I would really want to wrestle Charles Crowley. Or, in fact, let me change my answer. I need to change my answer entirely.
Is it the OTT guys?
No. There's a guy who wrestles for a company called
Championship
Wrestling, right? And his name's James Cena.
Oh, and yes. I have
been calling Venom Championship Wrestling out to give me James Cena. I am desperate. I will pay my own way to wherever they're going. They don't need to pay me. I just want to wrestle James Cena so bad.
Would you put on your CV as wrestling J.Cena? And then just leave it for the question.
No, with pride, I would capitalize James. And I just think, and the thing is, I've actually seen some of his matches, and he's actually pretty good. And I just think it would be, I'm never wrestling John Cena, so it's the second best thing. I really want to wrestle James Cena or Charles Crowley.
You need to get James Cena and get back to five star Raging Andy Organ together and form a super team.
I don't know if the UK, I'm pretty sure they are. Sunshine Machine, that's a tag team I really want to wrestle. Want to wrestle them, man. Or the I don't want to mess up their name. Is it Bolarama? Is that it?
Yeah, you were on a show with one of them.
I was on Spick Pins or something like that.
Yeah, I was on a show with them in Wales when I was teaming with Luch Scotland, and they are so good. Like, so good.
There was a tag team recently, a Community Pro, on the show we were on. They were called Freshness, or The Freshness. I don't know how they pronounce their name, but it's spelled FR. It's like Fresh NES, like Freshness. And as soon as I was watching them wrestle, I went to Sammy and I was like, mate, those boys are unreal. We'd have such a good time with them. It was very similar to when we seen Casino Brutale for the first time, and we thought we would have such a good time with them. And we did.
Actually, do you know what? That's another thing I'll throw out there just very quickly. We've already faced them. I would love to get a long... we didn't have as long as a match as I would have liked. I would love another match, whether it be like a 15-minute match with Casino Brutale. Casino Brutale are also one of, like, these two guys are, like, great. And I mean, like they're up there on the Scottish scene. They should be everywhere. And I don't just mean the UK. I mean all over. I mean, like Europe, States. They should be everywhere because, like, they're thinking about everything that they do. Like, it's 100%. We've come back from matches. And we've not even asked them. Because we've had a match with them, they've come up and they've given us advice. And it's helped us. Mm-hmm. So, like, these two are so good with everything that they do in the ring, and I would love to get another match of them.
I've got that noted and I missed it. Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Rabbi is such a handsome man.
I love the guys. I've ever seen them online through YouTube and stuff like that, but speaking to them and seeing their promos and stuff like that, they're just one of the, Aspen, Lost by Aspen, put out a top three tag teams in Scotland right now, and it was Foundation of the Future, Casino Brutale, Fair City Saints. And I was looking at that going, you know, it's hard. I mean, you could probably, fourth would be super debatable, maybe even third, but I think Foundation and Casino, you couldn't really argue them in that top three, certainly.
Foundation are great, man. They're so good. I've seen them at the first time I've seen them was at the last Respect show. I've seen them at a couple of community shows. Then most recently, but I've seen them at that Discovery show, the Time Warp one, where they came out as really old men. So fucking impressive, man. Those guys are really good. And obviously, I've seen stuff from like Zach Dynamite and stuff like that and his singles things. Then you've got the two big hosts next to him. I reckon we'd have a pretty good time with Foundations of the Future as well.
Who would be your third if you were going to go against all three?
Who would be our third? What, like another tag team?
No, I said
like a third member. Who's a third member?
Oh, man.
You, Billy, Moan, get involved. Get the single on, the Pokemon one.
You know what? I'm absolutely positive that Bruiser Brad would love to slap me. I think he would absolutely enjoy throwing me about quite willingly, and I don't think I could stop him. One of those things going, this is happening, isn't it? I'm going to die. Okay, cool.
For a third member, I would love Simon Miller, man. Like, Simon Miller is so good as well. So I'd be a good third member of Legends Never Die.
I'm the big guy here. Come on.
Fine. Okay, fine then. If you don't want a big guy, always get Robbie Caldwell.
Oh, Robbie's lovely, man. So good as well. So good.
I like that he's kind of properly went in. Seen his photos the last few Iron Girder shows. He's proper went for the Jeff Hardy aesthetic. He just went for it. He kind of did it in one of the cosplay rumbles, and he's just kind of kept it.
And it just works. I bumped into him over the weekend, man. I was so buzzing. Like, he's just so delightful. And he's so young. He's just done 20. Oh, like,
so many wrestlers. You've got what? Colton.
Right, Colton Davis, right?
We've got Colton. We've got your cousin, Ronan King. And then we've got Robbie. Like,
the King family is a long and fruitful lineage. But the amount of young, like, literally young talent is in age wise. Coming out of Scotland right now is absolutely wild. Because really, you and Luke King Sharp still count as that, because you guys are still below, what, 25? Colton Davis
I'm 23.
Colton Davis just turned 20. And he's what, you know, he's a wee guy, what, a solid 6 foot seven or something like that. He's still a wee guy. Don't understand why they call him Sky High, to be honest.
He really likes Ronan, D'Lo Brown.
He doesn't know who D'Lo Brown is. Don't let him kid you. I was like, do you know D'Lo Brown? He was like, is that the guy for Aces and Eights? Ronan King is killing it. Judas is killing it. It's, yeah, Scotland's
give me a match with Judas, please. I want a match with Judas. A ladder match if preferred.
Yeah, speaking of that, man, actually no, we'll get Mealy Hughes' questions out of the way because then we'll go back into Judas. So the second question was if you could face anybody in a tag team match from any time. Oh yeah, from any time. That adds an extra parameter to it. If you could face anybody in a tag team match from any time, who and why?
Oh.
The Rottens?
Not the Rottens, no, but Balls and Axel.
Ian Rotten now.
Forget about that one. That would be sick. Just throw chairs at each other and go absolutely mental. I mean, but then again, if you're also going for the ECW crowd, give me like Lance Storm and Justin Credo. Oh, Lance Storm and Chris Candido would be fucking crazy. That would be incredible. Oh, so many opportunities.
Cronus and Saturn.
The Exterminators?
Eliminators.
Eliminators.
Total Elimination.
Such a good move. I took that once off. I took a version of it off Buddy Matt, Buddy Roller, and Owen once on Aussie Makers. Any tag team. There's so many great ones out there. Purely for an educational point, give me Arn and Tully. I want to learn everything they've got to say about tag team wrestling. Do you know what I mean? Same with the Bulldogs as well, the British Bulldogs.
I'm thinking more like now. Like I would love like if we're talking like big names and stuff like that. Like I'd love like FTR, House of Black. I would love a match with House of Black just so I could take that fucking beautiful kick.
Which version do you want? The one with Aleister Black in it, or do you want like Brody King and?
I want Brody King because I would love to see you and Brody step in a ring with each other. I think it would be mental.
Another member of the King family.
Man,
wrestling has more than one royal family.
We should gather all these kings together. I mean, it was the Storm family that was going around for a while. Nicky, James, Lance, you know, yep. and now it's the King family that's.
Billy, I want you to do a podcast with all the kings and have it called The Family Reunion at Christmas. And that needs to be your Christmas special. And it's a quiz. It's a pub quiz. And it's all the kings together in a Christmas special family reunion.
As I currently don't have time to arrange that for this Christmas, maybe next year get Ronan, get Fulton, I'll get KOE, yeah, everyone on. And who else? Is there anyone else? No.
Probably in Scotland it is.
Kings of Catch? No, I don't think that's a thing now. But yeah, we could definitely do something.
I would
but...
like that needs no, to
Lewis
happen.
Lewis and Fraser Governor are doing their own thing now. That's a tag team actually.
Oh yeah, man.
Yeah, that would be an interesting one. Lewis Governor and Fraser Governor would be fun.
Yeah, Fraser is. We had him on quite recently. He's a very interesting individual. He's very. He's a guy that you look at him and go, Christ, you look a bit intense. And then you speak to him and he's got some of the wildest stories. I'm sure you either listened or he's already told you about the roller coaster.
No.
Right. I'm not going to spoil it for people. Go watch the Fraser or listen to the Fraser Gervin episode and there's a roller coaster story that you will not believe until you listen and then Google it as well.
Right here on the Scottish Wrestling Network.
It was a guy who I had like three notes about and ended up speaking for over an hour because it just kept going random and moving on to other subjects and things like that. bollocks. All right, two coughs. I've got two coughs in there. Wheelie has also asked, biggest wrestling influence?
Boz Mahoney is a massive one for me, definitely. Kevin Owens, honestly, just big guy wrestlers for me that don't necessarily adhere to what I would say the regular big guy wrestlers are. Because you've got your Kevin Nash and all that, but then you get the likes of Bam Bam Bigelow, Big Van Vader, Kevin Owens, Balls Mahoney. These are those big guys that had that, you know, they could still move. Do you know what I mean? They weren't always the lumbering big guy. I just find that super interesting. That's mine anyway. as a wrestler?
That's a very...
Just say Rey Mysterio.
I don't want to, though. But, like, yes, he was a big part of it, but, like...
Sin Cara.
No, absolutely
Mystical.
Not. No.
El Santo.
Juan Cena.
You know, we'll go with Juan Cena. Yes, Juan Cena is my idol. But no, like, I would also say Kevin Owens is in there. Like, I've gone back and watched his like older stuff recently, and like he's fucking great. Same with Adam Cole, going back Ring of Honor stuff. I'd even say CM Punk Ring of Honor. Another one who I like, I would love like to say is. Again, going back and watching his stuff is Johnny Storm. Johnny
Did
Storm.
Did you know that recently no,
this is not happening.
Sami Sparx kicked down a locker room door and challenged Johnny Storm to a fist fight.
So I've known Johnny since I was 16, 17. And
British wrestling legend Johnny Storm.
Our friendship is very. He'll come see me and call me a shit wrestler, and I'll say the same thing back. And I was sat in the car with Lou, looking sharp, and I said, just to give you a heads up, when Johnny sees me, don't be surprised with how me and him talk to each other, because it's happened before where we've said hello to each other in not the nicest of ways, and everyone's gone, you can't talk to him like that. And he's like, and I'm like, he doesn't care. Like, I've known him since I was young. So, show finished. And Krieger comes up to me with Lucha Diaz and goes, mate, Johnny's raging with you. I'm like, what? He's like, yeah, no, he's really angry. I'm like, about what? He's like, I don't know. He won't tell me, but he's asking for Lou. And he's asking who your trainer is. And he wants to speak to your trainer. I said, don't wind me up on this. And literally, Krieger grabs me by the shoulder and goes, I'm telling you now, I would joke and bam you up about a lot of things. This is not one of them. So I went and found Lou. I went, Lou, what's going on? He went, don't know, all the noise that he wants to speak to me. And he looks pissed off. So I go up the stairs and I'm knocking on doors, like trying to find him. And now he's sat in the room with Taylor Bryden and Joey Legend.
I was the voice of at one point.
You were, yes.
And Joey Legend, I'm like, so I knock on the door. I open the door. I'm like, is Johnny in here? And he's like, all right. And Johnny comes out of the shower with a towel on. I'm like, what's your fucking problem?
Immediately. In front of Joey Legend.
In front of Joey Legend. I'm like, what's your problem? I'm like, what you want about? I went, why are you pissed off? And he was like, it doesn't matter. And I went, no, it does. If you've got a problem, come speak to me. You don't need to go to my trainer. If you've got a problem, come speak to me. And he went, well, what are you going to do? I went, well, what do you want me to do? And he went, go fuck yourself. And I went, fuck off. And I just walked out. And it was only when I got down the stairs, I went, fuck, what have I just done? Immediately. I literally went and found Craig. I was like, go fuck yourself. Immediately. Yeah. And they're dying of laughter.
And then
I went and shook Joey Legend's hand and went, sorry for barging into your locker room. Like, he went, oh no, it's fine. Me and the guys used to do this to Abyss all the time because he's got really bad like confidence issues. I'm like, oh, that's good to know. I was like, thanks for telling me that. You used to like absolutely bully Abyss with the same problems.
Wrestling hating.
It was so fucking funny. Like, we wouldn't have obviously done it to anyone else, but it's the fact that it was Johnny Storm and it was me that told him to do it because I knew, obviously, know your relationship with Johnny Storm. We've been out for pints and all that together. I was like, Johnny, you need to do this, boys. It'll be so funny.
Like, literally, I'll tell you this now. Like, this is the type of relationship me and Johnny have. We were watching a match of him on, what was it, Ring of Honor or something like that?
No, we were watching, it was a TNA match he had.
TNA match. And I literally, he comes out and he's got like long hair in the match. And I literally, I messaged him. I went, just to let you know, by the way, you with long hair look shit. Good thing that your hair's receding. And then I put, hope you're having a good day. I got a message back 2 days later. Fuck you very much. And then I just put, love you.
but yes, Fulton was the voice of Joey Legend on my most successful video on YouTube of ITV's The Rise and Fall of ITV's Celebrity Wrestling, which is still, I don't think I know this,
by the way.
It's like, only half an hour long. It's half an hour long.
I definitely told you.
And it was beautiful.
I definitely told you at the time I was doing it, but yeah, it was really funny. I remember Celebrity Wrestling being on. I just don't remember fucking anything else about it. I just remember it being on.
It's so weird. I'm so glad I got Joey Legend. I got him twice on the podcast. One as on location when he came to Elgin, and then once as an actual episode. And both times I still asked about ITV Celebrity Wrestling because it still fascinates me to this day. I need to get D'Lo Brown. I tried, and then Twitter had their new rules, and now I've got to try and work out how to contact D'Lo Brown.
You've done some stuff with Impact as well. Haven't you? I've seen that. You did some of the interviews.
Oh, I got Will Ospreay on for 2 minutes, and then
you had the other Gail Kim as well, did you not? And like,
oh, aye, beautiful people as well.
I'm in the world, Billy.
I still don't know how I've managed that. I think because I used to pester them to try and get Joe Henry when he signed, and then the guys just went, I'll let you know when we can, but we've put you into the press pool as well. I was like, all right, okay, cool. Then I was like, should I keep it Scottish based or keep it like just wrestling? And then Will Ospreay was on. I was like, X Cup, name of your team. But no, it's the, probably the weirdest thing. That against Scotty Tottie is probably the two weirdest things about this podcast that's happened. Other than the possible eventuality of us sitting here in our rooms, respectively, with our shirts off at the end of this episode. Right. So we're an hour 45-ish in. And we haven't even got to Judas's questions yet.
Can we just skip them and just say yes to all of them now? Just say yes collectively, and then not know what the questions are. No, it's not. I know he's asked about DMG.
What I love about that question now, because I don't know if you listened to Mickey's Mosh Pit, but Mickey Vago, that question has now went into that podcast as well. And when I listened to it, I was like, oh my god, this is the most terrible crossover I've ever seen.
This is going to be the thing that Judas is known for when people are like, who started that question? Judas Gray.
The fact that he does it when he first meets people as well, which is just incredible. Anyway, we'll go through the Twitter ones because there's only three there. There's a fourth one, but it's...
Wait, there's more off of Twitter?
Instagram as well, yeah.
Oh, for fuck's sake, Judas.
Right, let's go. We'll rapid fire them.
Does it hurt being English?
I wouldn't know.
Yes, you would. You know the best. No.
Shit. DMG?
No, absolutely not.
I'd rather not.
Especially considering you said you love my mother. Piece of shit.
yeah, is Sami Sparx, spelled incorrectly, jealous of my ladder spot?
Yes, absolutely. Wish that was me. Also, stop spelling my name wrong. You dick.
He's also followed up with, is Samantha Spartacus jealous of my ladder spot?
Go fuck yourself.
Yes, they are.
You shut up. Don't help this case. My name's not Samantha.
Fulton King's specific question here. Is it hard being English?
Yes.
I'm not English, Jess. You know this. You're from fucking Edinburgh. That's just England, but somehow colder.
I don't know if this is related to that question, but he's just put, are you not ashamed?
It's definitely related to that question. And if it was English, I would be.
Opinions on how much it sucks to be English?
Fucking English, Judas. This is like the solo one as well. There was like five different variations of this question.
Can we just answer them with, go fuck yourself?
Right. I'm going to get creative.
Who is the dumb one between you two?
Fulton.
That's an absolute lie, and you know
it. No, absolutely not.
Sammy, where's OTT based? Which country is OTT based in?
Don't do this. Don't make me say this word on the fucking podcast, you horrible person.
What was the other thing as well you were talking about?
Ireland.
You were talking about a queue at an airport, and you called it a waiting line.
What's this? I don't remember this.
You've been hitting the head way more than me at this point.
I will like to point out that Judas has spent two. It has spelt two, T O O. So
the answer's him.
Yes.
Yes. Out of that. Again, don't know if this is directed at either one of you or both. Tell your mom I love and miss her.
That's my mother. That's my mother. Yeah, I will. Stop trying to get me to stop saying you love my mother, and then 2 minutes later asking me, do I want to join Dead Mum Gang? Like, no. The answer is no. You asked me this last time, and then you saw me and you said, you have a pass from ever being in it. Why are you still asking? Go away.
Could have been asking me. Doesn't know my mum.
Oh yeah, you know what, Fulton, do you want to join DMG?
Nah, my mum's all right.
Exactly.
You seem on the fence about it, but
she's seen me wrestle now, you know what I mean?
No.
She didn't like it.
Wait till after Christmas.
Get your presents first, aye. Makes sense. And the final question that he's asked is, why am I your favourite wrestler in Scotland?
Do not.
Nah. Do you know what, though?
He's
I
up
will say it. He's definitely the Judas. As much as I despise putting him over, he's pretty fucking fantastic.
I find Judas wrestling as good as Doink the Clown. Like, I feel like they're on the same category, which isn't a bad thing. But I definitely feel like if Judas wanted to do a Doink the Clown gimmick, he could do it.
Which Doink the Clown?
It's Matt Bourne. He's got the Matt Bourne. Matt Bourne. Yeah.
You think so?
No.
He doesn't seem as aggressive as Matt Bourne to me. He's not. He's not rough enough to be.
Either
Matt
that, Bourne. Or I'd say Eugene. Like, you could do either gimmick, to be honest, Judas.
I think Judas is a great wrestler. Terrible at asking questions, though.
Is that all of them on?
That's all of them. That's all the ones. I'll double check the notifications just to make sure.
No, don't do that.
But I don't think he has, because every time I like retweeted it, he kept asking questions on that one, so I had to go find them all. But yeah, so I think that's them all asked. So I think that's all the questions we've asked. I've went through my notes kinda. So I think it's almost time, guys, if we're doing this.
Oh. right,
okay. Let's do this.
Fuck's sake, man. I nearly took the mask off.
Yes!
Yeah!
Right.
Fulton. Yeah, hold on. Got to take our photos.
And we're going to send these all to The Rock.
Yep.
Oh, I just see my stuff in the background.
Right, we all sending it to The Rock now?
Yes.
Right. Like, hold on. Everyone do it on the podcast so that you can show your Instagram to prove that you've done it.
How awkward would it be if The Rock's blocked one of us?
Then you send it on Facebook.
What's the message?
Check this out, big man.
No, send it and then put, oops, wrong person.
Just want to say, big fans from over here at the SWN podcast.
I don't want to be picky here, but I've taken my picture and I can only see my head, so there's no tit involved. I feel like I need to retake it, so I'm going to just...
Wait, it says I can't send the message. Wait,
mine won't let me send a picture.
Yeah, mine won't let me send it.
Oh, I'm going to Twitter, hold on.
Right, hold on, I'm just going to retake, so I've got...
No, I've got the photo. You're trying to get this perfect, Billy.
I feel, well, because you can only see my head, so I just feel like I need to actually see some...
Oh, no, you need to go lower. Like, just do it that way.
There we go. Get the Twitter in the background as well.
I'm gonna just send it on Facebook because I can't. Oh, I can't send it on Facebook. Are we just gonna have to put this on Twitter?
Mine's is just me and Sammy. Really, you're kind of you're a little bit. You can't really see you in it, Billy. If you want,
that's all right.
I've tagged SWN.
This account can't receive your message because they don't allow new message requests.
Right? Do you know what? Fulton, do me a favor, put a tweet out there with the photo and just at The Rock, and then we'll put the photo underneath it, because this is going to be on the podcast anyway, so it's going to be out there for people to see. So let's just put it out there and give no comment. We just won't say what it's about. So you put it out and then we'll quickly put the photo underneath it.
I'm quite happy. Oh, you can't really see it. I'm quite happy with my picture, to be perfectly
honest. Lower your brightness if you want to show us.
That is peak performance of man there.
What a babe. You're so grizzly.
I nearly took off the mask when I went to do it, by the way. I went like that to take it off and then realised. Right. Have you done it yet?
I'm doing it as we speak. Hold on.
So with that,
come on, guys.
As we're all, God, I'm so cold.
Yeah, bro, it's it's not great.
At The Rock, big fan from over here at the Scottish Wrestling Network. Have a Merry Christmas. Just for a wee picture.
Have you put it out? Have you added us in it?
Yeah, well, yep. I've tagged you in it.
Right, hold on. Let me go find the tweet so I can put it underneath it.
Yeah, do the same.
It's not showing up for me. Wait.
Oh, I tagged you in it, Sammy.
Why is it not showing up? Hold on. If I go to media, it should be there, right? There it is. That's a quality photo, Fulton.
I'm trying to do the people's eyebrow on it. But I'm also very happy at the same time. So I just look like I've got a squint.
God, I wish I'd put my washing away before without about doing this.
Oh, what a babe. Oh, you've got your pants in a picture of The Rock. That's incredible.
I know. Pizza pants. That's what you need. Oh, Westy's liked it. That makes me feel really uncomfortable.
Merry Christmas to all. Oh, wait, it's after Christmas. Fuck.
Oh, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, guys.
Johnson.
Happy New Year, guys.
Right.
Come watch us beat the shit out of Termination Z.
In the Rugby Rumble.
There's your promo.
Rugby Rumble.
And with that, let's wrap up the podcast. And we can all regret what we've just done. This has been one of the weirdest podcasts I've done this season. I can say that confidently. But I've been joined by Fulton King, Sami Sparx of Legends Never Die. Where can people find out more about you? On the old social medias.
Follow our Twitters. We've got we've got a TikTok that we don't post on under Legends Never Die, but we promise we will at some point. So you can find me on Sami Sparx on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram. You can find Fulton at.
You can find me at The Fulton King on Twitter. I think it's the same on Instagram, which is Adam FULTN, and on Facebook as well. You can follow the Fulton King page.
And again, like I said, we've got a TikTok under Legends Never Die that we don't post on, but it's still funny to go see the early clips. That's where you can see what we said in the start of this podcast. Midnight Breakdown being hit, and you can again hit me up if you find anybody else that has done it before us, because I refuse to believe anyone else has.
There you go, full circle, bookended the episode. Thank you for joining us. Let's go put our clothes back on.
Thanks for having us, Billy.
Thank you, man.